Welcome to Dare to Dream. This show has been nominated for two People's Choice Podcast Awards and a Webby Award, and it's always consistently ranked in the top best podcasts in self-improvement in all of the USA, as well as in other countries. Thank you to all of you for joining and for enjoying and understanding this number one transformation conversation. This show is sponsored by Dr. Dane here and Access Consciousness. They do amazing work out in the world, and if you'd like to become a facilitator or check out some of their amazing classes, go to drdanehere.com or accessconsciousness.com. Debbi Dachinger is a certified coach whose expertise is visibility and media. Visibility is so important. If you have a business, if you have a product, if you have a message, it must be seen and heard, right? How do you do that? So many people want to write a book. What's stopping you? If you don't know where or how to start writing that book, you're not alone. Don't throw money away. Don't waste time. Learn the system to easily write and self-publish your book. You can join the book writing group where you get live guidance from an expert. Go to debbidachinger.com/visible visionaries, debbidachinger.com/visible visionaries, and write your book this year. Debbi Dachinger coaches people to write a page-turner book, takes their book to a guaranteed international bestseller, and shows clients the system to be interviewed on media and podcasts and get massive results. You all want massive results because this is how you use media to locate your tribe, fill workshops, sell books, and gain exposure. Connect with her, debbidachinger.com/visible visionaries. How can humans begin to use our new emerging capacities? My guest is returning back to the show because the first conversation was so sumptuous. So I welcome back to the show Rebecca Dawson, a channel for information about the Earth, the human race, and other planetary systems for over 20 years. Rebecca's identity and view of the world changed dramatically when she was 18 years old, after she spontaneously became a channel when her plan for life involved studying to become an architect. For over two decades, Rebecca has been the channel for expressing the wisdom of aspects such as Saint Germain, Kuthumi, and Serapis Bey. Rebecca offers the latest channeled information on the current state of humanity and the planet, the mechanics of dimensional reality, and the nature of consciousness. Rebecca is the author of three books and lives in Perth, Australia. And to learn more about her, go to net. Remember net. She's going to catch you in the net. Rebecca Dawson, DAWSON.net. And I welcome back to the show, Rebecca Dawson. So great to have you.
Thank you for having me again. It's great to be here.
Yeah. We went kind of deep last time. So that always excites me a lot. The unexpected, expect the unexpected. And let's start with more of the global. Let's start there. So just based on your bio, you offer this channeled information, current state of humanity and the planet, mechanics of dimensional reality, nature of consciousness. Is there a latest, something that is up right now or that is coming to your attention right now regarding specifically the mechanics of dimensional reality?
Well, there's a lot going on with time at the moment, which is really interesting. And we've been talking about this in the last few weeks. So a paradigm shift is, as many people are understanding it, from 3D to 5D and beyond, we're going to have some adjustments with time and how we sense time. And so for many of us in the last few weeks, we're going through a finishing off or a completion of how time has been for us. And when that begins to happen, it can often feel like everything around us is slowing down or coming to a halt, but there's a bit of a rush that's going on internally. And a lot of us are feeling that right now. There's a real sense of agitation and maybe dissatisfaction, and we really want to move and we want to put out our energy into something, but everything else is slowing down and stopping. And so we have a really interesting window right now where we get to watch the completion of everything that's come before us before we start rushing forward into something new. So I just wanted to start with that today, because a lot of us are in this place right now where we're champing at the bit to go forward, but we don't want to miss this opportunity to see everything that has unfolded in that previous cycle of humanity actually come into what we call full bloom, which is really important. And when we say full bloom, we talk about duality coming into its absolute fullness.
Okay. First question, when you talk about the completion of, can you explain that a little more? What are the specifics that are being completed?
So we're moving out of the old blueprint, what we call the old, in comparison to what's happening now or what's imminent, blueprint for humanity. And that blueprint was really about the extremes of duality and how far we can go, saturating the blueprint of experience for dualistic type living. And when that comes to a fullness, it's almost like we've been through it so many times, every single permutation of what could possibly happen within the boundaries or ramifications of that blueprint for possibility has now unfolded. And when it's only when that blueprint for experience becomes so full that we actually get to move into something new. It's almost like a tapestry that becomes so full. There's nothing else that can be woven there. And so really that's where we are right now. I mean, we see that because there's such a flooding of consciousness now. We're not in an experience anymore where we're forgetting everything that came before. We're actually starting to really encompass history of humanity. A lot of people are starting to look back and say, wow, look at that. We did that and we did that and we did that. A lot of people are looking at alternative histories for the planet. You know, what is the truth of what we've been through? So we're no longer living in a very limited window of reference. We're now starting to get the whole picture. And this is highly indicative of a blueprint that's coming to its completion. I like to look at that like a flower or a rose coming into full bloom. There's the seed and the potential there. And the greater it gets, we begin to see all the different aspects of humanity, all the different things that we've been through. And because we're in a dualistic experience, that's just not all the things that we feel proud of as a species, but it's all the other things as well, because that's the nature of duality. So right now we're seeing all of this on full display. And I think it's important to give ourselves time and a moment to actually appreciate the fullness of that design.
Coming into blueprints and living in duality, completing things. And when we talk about dimensional reality and how time is shifting, when you say those words, what I think about is other realities, other lifetimes, other planets. Is there shifts going on there where there is more flow, more possibility or ease for those fluctuations to happen, that other beings from another time or another planet may with greater ease come here, or that maybe our beings known or unbeknownst to us are somehow shifting also to other places and spaces?
Absolutely. I mean, if we're in a third dimensional reality blueprint, you know, duality is all about containment. Absolutely. I mean, we've learned that with our bodies, we've learned that with sense of boundaries and limitations. So the Earth reality has been existing within a sense of containment. As that blueprint comes to completion, it's almost like we're so saturated with ourselves and what we can do and what's probable. We've done it all. We were looking for something new. Consciousness expands. It begins to stretch that fabric of reality or dimensional fabric, like the tapestry stretching, and holes start to appear. This is when consciousness really starts to flood our experience. So the things that have always been there, other aspects of life, other civilizations, dimensions, both that would seem distant in terms of time and space, and that which has always been here in our Earth reality that we haven't been able to view, suddenly becomes visible. And that's indeed what we're experiencing right now. We're experiencing a release from containment. So with that, inevitably, there's going to be more awareness of what there is that we couldn't view before. And many of us are already sensing it. Many of us already have an inner knowing about it. It's going to be very interesting in the next 5 to 8 years when it actually starts to become visible.
Oh, really, yeah. I'm so here and down for that. Do you know any clients who are having really specific experiences with this, or are you having very specific new experiences with this?
Well, yes, actually, I am having a lot of people from around the world contact me saying that they're having this awareness of themselves in another location, another place in the galaxy or beyond, or they're feeling that support. And again, it's the opening of our senses out of containment, out of third dimensional reality into fifth dimensional reality that allows us to begin to experience that more. It's really important to know as well that it doesn't happen that often that a blueprint for experience comes to its fullness like it is here. So there's an awful lot of attention on our Earth reality right now. There's an awful lot of focus that's gathering at this time to witness this blooming of the rose. And it's an incredible time to celebrate because we're seeing duality in its absolute fullness at its peak. Mm. It's like having a rare flower come into bloom, and it takes hundreds of thousands of years, and here we are. Mm. So there's a lot of what we would call otherworldly influence, other dimensional influence and viewing at this time. I do want to make it an important point about the word influence, because a lot of people kind of have a sense perhaps that things are being manipulated by other beings, dimensions, and so on. Mm. It's important to remember that a blueprint is created in its design at the beginning, and it's going to fulfill itself. The influence that I'm talking about, or we're talking about, is the viewing, the presence, the ability to see it. Because the more that consciousness can recognize this blooming, the easier it's going to be for us to begin something new.
Mm.
That's the flooding at this time.
So understanding the nature of the new reality right now as we transition into this new era, the current collective, the personal human condition that listeners are experiencing. Let's dive into this. How can we start the deep dive, if you will, with the physical experience?
Well, the physical experience has been, I mean, that's been an ongoing transition for people for at least the last 15 years. Mm-hmm. A lot of people talk about ascension symptoms and how that's unfolding within the body. In essence, as the masters explain it, that's about unlocking the containment of the human body. Instead of being a closed system, we're becoming an open system, which means we're open-ended with what we can do, open-ended with what we can connect to. We're no longer a closed environment. It's the same with the Earth reality, the end of containment. So right now there's a convergence going on between the brain and the heart. There's two galaxies that are merging right now. And as that happens, the brain and the heart within the human is also merging. That's happening through a number of different aspects of us. There's a new gland in the back of the neck called the Ekbar that's going to allow us to speak our cosmic intelligence, which is available through our physical body before it passes through the brain necessarily and gets fact-checked or referenced. And the pineal gland, of course, is getting on board with all of that circuitry. There's an interesting new pathway going between the heart and the eyes, which is enabling us to be able to view again before we can reference for it with what the mind knows. So all of this rewiring is happening right now. So a lot of people are having headaches. There's a lot of throat discomfort. There's a lot of heart stuff going on because all of that is being recalibrated to work in unison. We've actually did an event recently about the new heart and how that works. And eventually over the next 3 years, all of the organs in the body are going to start to work together in synergy rather as separate components within the body. And that's really important because we've learned how to define ourselves in terms of multiple parts making up a whole, so that when one component has a bit of an issue, the whole system breaks down. Almost like a point on an electrical board, one bit goes and the whole circuit's destroyed. So we're moving more into magnetic resonance operation again, which is a more natural way for us to be. That's how other species within the galaxy are operating, which means that it either all works or none of it works.
Hmm. So is this a good thing?
It's seems wonderful.
Because when you say it either all works or it doesn't work, that's a little bit right. Precarious.
Well, that's the pulse of life. That's fifth dimensional reality. That's the natural cosmic rhythm, is the pulse or propulsion, not cause and effect and process and progress, which means that you either exist or you don't exist. Hmm. There's no breakdown of the system. There's no illness or disease or disintegration or degeneration.
Wow.
It's just you exist or you don't exist, which has indeed happened many times throughout the Earth's existence with civilizations. They're there and then the consciousness is not there. And that's actually our natural state as humans. It's only within third dimensional reality that we get to experience the slow motion process of creation. That's the gift of our world. Mm.
Slow motion of creation. Well, now yes. I want to go back to when you said cosmic intelligence. Can you say more about that? How that was very fascinating. You were mentioning that there's something new back in the back of our necks or skulls that's going to be operating in a new way. Talk more about that. What does that mean? What does it look like? How will it be to experience that?
Well, that first came to my attention in about 2017, that there's a new gland that's at the base of the skull that's going to enable wisdom from our cosmic center, our connection to all things, not just within our Earth reality, but within the cosmos, the intelligence and information source that comes from within, to be expressed before it passes through our reference or memory systems of the brain. Because if the brain, or mind brain, we call it, doesn't have a reference for it, it will either dismiss it or it will attribute it to something else. That's why when we have amazing experiences of consciousness or, you know, spirit or awakening, it's very, very difficult to remember it, to describe it. It was there and then it was gone. Something happened. I don't know what it was. So this is going to enable us to express what it is that we know without having to filter it or edit it. Which is wonderful, which means we're now operating from what's available in the present moment instead of what we already know.
It sounds like there'll be a new capacity to allow and receive. That communication will be, you know, whereas before there were a lot of people in our tribe who would have to keep quiet at a certain level. And I think that's still true. Most of us, we can be here on this podcast and, you know, there's events we can go to, your classes, there's so many ways we can convene, the books we read, and we know we're reading truth, right? And this is what we know to be so. And yet when you go very mainstream, there are so many people who poo-poo all of this. And if I understand you correctly, with this new cosmic intelligence, it sounds like there'll be a whole new way of receiving information, understanding information, and being able to communicate that with a really, you know, intuitive, heart-based knowing. Does that ring a bell?
Absolutely, because otherwise all the information we think that we have and knowledge we think that we have is actually memory-based. And if it's memory-based, it belongs to the blueprint of experience that we've already had that's coming to its fullness. All of us who are, you know, awakening on the planet at this time, we want new. We're wired for new now. Nothing that's available is satisfying. We've done it. And there are many people saying, there's nothing I really want. I want something, but I don't know what it is. And that's because we're now this open-ended system. When you're open-ended, you're no longer contained. You're actually becoming the crucible. So things are becoming birthed out of you. And this shape, this arc, is going to become very significant in the next 5 years of teachings on the planet. Many teachers are going to start talking about this, the shape of the arc and the lens and the crucible. Because this is what happens when humanity opens itself up and we begin to birth new things. Now, the voice is very important, because how we've learned is in this contained, closed system experience of humanity, when we have an awakening or we have awareness of consciousness or cosmos, it's very private. It's very personal. It can only be understood within. It can't really be communicated. It's difficult to share it. It's very sometimes isolated experience, which is why, you know, in history, you would go and disappear into a cave for many years and have your experience with consciousness there. Now that we're becoming an open system again, open to the cosmos and the galaxy and within ourselves, voice is once again becoming incredibly important. Because when something emerges within you now, instead of it being your personal experience, it becomes something that's birthed for the collective. How is it brought into this field of resonance? Through sound. In the beginning, there was the word. And so this is why we're feeling now the urge to actually express what it is that we're knowing, experiencing, feeling. It's not an oversharing, it's a birthing, it's a creation. Very important.
I can attest that it's amazing sometimes to hear the things you share, because I resonate so strongly. You know, as somebody who got into this business, it'll be 14 years in June, and Dare to Dream, it was like, I was so excited to share how to create dreams. I started this show way before it had anything to do with channeling and transformation and psychic and all this stuff. It was just, let's talk about creating dreams. I wrote books about this. And it's always been really amazing to me to have a list and then set upon each one and create it out in the world. I mean, it's the hugest high in the best way, because it's a life changer when you show yourself what's really possible and that there are no limits. It's very exciting to give yourself that which you desire by your own design. And I have said this for the past few years, like, and that's for a Dare to Dream girl. It's like, I've created it all. I got to a point where I was so, I want to use a Yiddish word for anybody understands it, famished, like, ugh, just like sort of frustrated that I said, I'll create a list for my dog. I'm sure there are things my dog would like to create. She must have a bucket list or a wish list. And it was fun. We created dreams for her. But that's very much how I feel. Yes, are there still countries I'd like to visit? You know, yes, there's still always projects that come up that I get excited about, new directions. But that feeling you're describing is so, so prevalent for me. I didn't know that it also was for so many other people, this feeling of like, yeah, I really am not sure what's next. I know I've done so much already, and there's sort of this energy around it. And I love how you describe this crucible, this opening, this birthing of what's to come. And it sounds like you're saying to come through us, that something greater is happening. Is that right?
Absolutely. Because, you know, as humans, as a species, we're designed to create, not replicate and repeat. And now because we're moving out of this linear sense of time now, which is the 3D, where we have a progression. This is the slow motion replay of creation. That's the joy of 3D. We get to watch process happen. We're moving into 5D now, and in 5D, we get both experiences, which means we get the experience of instantaneous creation, and we also get the experience of then watching the slow motion replay. So much like if you were watching a sports match live on television and someone kicks a goal, it's like, oh, and it happens in the blink of an eye. What happens in that moment? You get the feeling state. You get the rush. Your brain doesn't really know what's happened because it's happened so fast. But, oh, something's happened. And then you get the slow motion replay and you can see exactly how the ball was lined up with the goal. And isn't that amazing? And then you can appreciate how it happened and the skill in it and the genius of it. But the rush you get is in the instantaneous, in the new, in the unexpected. So when we move into fifth dimensional reality, rather than just the slow motion replay of creation where everything is, we have to think about it, there's a process, what are the steps? In 5D, we have an experience where we get the feeling state rush, oh my gosh, something's happening. And quite often we don't know what it is, but we'll feel it within ourselves. Or there's a sudden inspiration and then it's gone. And then we get the slow motion replay. But the difference is that we're more focused now, those who are really conscious right now, we're more focused of birthing that feeling state of something new is happening, something new is occurring, because that's what's seeding the new into our earth reality. And then what happens is you let go of needing to be involved in the unfolding, because you're aware enough to know it's just being birthed. Now we get the joy of watching that come into being on our planet. So it's less labor and push and more birthing through feeling state and creation. That's why we're the crucible now instead of the ball that's rolling along. Very important, because we're moving in and out. One important thing to know about this is that right now we're so used to getting the feeling of the rush in the process. And right now there's no feeling in the process. It's dull. It's dead. There's no energy in it. So we're only getting the feeling in those moments where there's that rush and then we're pulsing out again and there's nothing. So a lot of people are feeling excited and then there's absolutely nothing. As soon as they get involved in the process, there's no joy. So it's important to know that there's nothing wrong with you. It's just that you're now birthing. You can get your joy from watching it rather than feeling like you're the one that's creating the unfolding.
So I would like a little more details. I'm with you. I'm completely with you. So when you say no joy in the process and that, so something's being birthed out of you, what can we do to facilitate this if we're not in process and that's not going to really help us or probably what we're creating? Are we just to surrender and let go and back up? What are we doing? What are we being?
When we're in process, when we think that we are the ones that are creating the slow motion replay, which in reality it's already being created, but all of our focus goes into believing that we're doing that slow motion replay. When our energy is not so much in that push and that labor of donating our energy to that, we become more available in the present moment. And in the present moment, we start to feel more. We start to feel that rush of inspiration and then neutrality, and then a rush of inspiration and then nothing. And what's important is to recognize it and allow it, because there are moments throughout the day where suddenly you feel really, really alive. Suddenly all your cells are buzzing. Recognize that those are the moments that you're birthing something new into the earth reality. Then it's not so much about what do I need to do to create, because in that moment you can acknowledge it, be in agreement with it, and then sit back and look at what's unfolding. Wow, look at this that's happening, that's new. So we should really be keeping our eye on the new, because there's a lot of pressure. You know, what am I going to do that's new? Well, how, what will I create? How will I do it? I'm sitting here and I'm not really doing anything new. How do I get into creating the new? The new happens through feeling state in the present moment in 5D.
And the pineal gland, that's interesting. What is happening to the pineal gland? And is there a new way that our bodies or beings will be using it?
Well, that's been happening for quite some time now. Actually, the pineal was one of the first things to really start to come back online as the system was becoming saturated and we were beginning to open up again. So a lot of people at the moment are having their vision affected, and they might believe that, especially in the left eye, they might think that that's got to do with, you know, the mechanics of the muscles in their eyes and their lens and whatever. It's actually because things are getting rewired within the brain. And just as the cosmic heart is connecting through the Ekbar and the pineal, so too are the eyes and the visual cortex. That's all running through there as well. So we're beginning to actually see beyond third dimensionality now. So we're seeing things that are there one moment and aren't there the next. And that's part of that propulsion energy of 5D. Because remember what we were saying before, when we move into resonance, it either exists or it doesn't. There's no process. Yeah. So we see something and then it's gone. And we're also going to be experiencing that in things like relationships. It's there and then it's gone. Or opportunities, it's there and then it's gone. So vision is being affected by that. That's all pineal. Pineal is the pulse, operates in a pulse.
You know, I have been doing since, let's see, about 6 months, I've been seeing a practitioner who does something called NAETE. I don't know if you know this, N-A-E-T. And so it's a beautiful, beautiful practice. It's way beyond that, but it's medicine. It was created moons ago by an Indian doctor. And there are certainly a lot of people here in the United States who practice it, acupuncturists, chiropractors, and regular doctors. But essentially what it is the body expressing, this is what I'm allergic to. And there's a beautiful, so simple method that the allergy is cleared in 24 hours. And so I came upon this many, many years ago when I had a huge flare up out of nowhere. I'd never been allergic to anything. And this literally 24 hours, the rash, everything that was going on was gone. So I bring this up because I started having just like some digestive things last year. And I was like, let's check this out. So this woman's amazing, but I'm telling you this story. I keep going to her because I just find the process fascinating. She cleared so much. I could check out at this point, but I love the process. And the last time I went to her, they have vials. And she was testing my body. And she said, oh, your pineal gland. I was like, well, that's really interesting. Yeah. So there's some kind of, she would call it an allergic reaction, but there is something that's off, that's not congruent, not aligned. And so we did the treatment. It's very easy. And yes, I go back when I get tested, I can promise you, I already know, because I heard when she said pineal, I'm like, yeah, we need to do that. I got it clear. But I know when she muscle tests me, I will be so strong. And so to hear you say this, it's almost like my body is trying to catch up and open up and, you know, become whatever it is. And I feel like now hearing what you just said, also with this NAETE that was just found with the pineal gland, that there'll be this sort of a click, something more accessible and easier for my pineal gland to do and be.
Well, it's interesting because, again, the slow motion replay of what's already happened. So in my view, you're having an experience of watching it open up. I feel that it's already opened up and that it happened some time ago for you. Oh. But you're now having an experience of, now I get to go through that process of what that feels like to have that open up. So you get both. It's interesting that you talk about that. About 8 years ago, I had, I was working in a natural medical clinic, and there was a colleague that had one of these machines. I can't remember what it's called now, but it goes through and it tests some sort of quantum machine, every single part of your body. And it comes out with a reading. It was quite expensive to import to Australia from Germany. And the thing that came up about it was that my pineal was completely dysfunctional or wasn't working at all, which was quite interesting because at the time I was actually working as a medical intuitive, because I can see into the body, into the cells and the DNA and all of the energy fields. So I was helping out in the health industry doing that. And so my ability to see beyond 3D has always been really sharp. And when I checked in about that, and I was thinking, well, this is interesting that it's pretty much the only thing this machine picked up was my pineal was off, is that it was operating at a frequency that the machine couldn't pick up.
Oh, wow.
So I think that's an important point too, because when we do go and get tested for things, let's embrace the possibility that we're now working beyond the limitations of certain areas of testing. I think that's really important to know as well. Sometimes, you know, the more conscious we become, we actually supersede what is considered to be normal. And that can be with all sorts of things. That can be with the heart, with the brain, with the nervous system, that it's difficult to ascertain with the current technology or ways of measuring where we actually are.
Yeah, that is a really cool point of view. I like that a lot. So essentially, there's nothing wrong with me. Everything has been online and probably then some for a while. And yeah, that's really amazing that that happened to you. And you were able to perceive, no, the frequency that this is emitting is just, it's not perceivable here with this machine.
That's right.
Kind of stuff.
That's right. So it's good to know, you know, instead of, it's good to get support, definitely, and to be able to get that reassurance about where you are. But there needs to be an inner knowing too. Does it feel like everything's functioning okay?
Yeah. So I want to ask at this point if you, the masters, would be willing to give us a message to talk to us about something that might be really germane, obviously, to this conversation, but also in general to what we'd like to be doing. I think with the opening up of the world right now, you know, people are like sort of getting out there, like all of us trying to figure out a little bit. Well, this, we all know this is going to be a new world, but like, What do we do?
how do we do it? That's right. Okay, no problem. So you can jump in anytime and ask questions as well. We're very conversational when we move into this state of being. So my voice will change a little bit, my mannerisms a little bit, but otherwise it's all just going to continue on in the conversation. Okay?
Beautiful. That would be all wonderful. Right. Thank you.
Greetings to you, blessed one, we are with you. Oh, yes. And indeed, it is a challenging time for humanity because you can feel that everything is new, but externally, things look very familiar. What you are seeing, in essence, is a continuation of history as it brings itself into completion. And yet many an awakened human at this time feels displaced within it. It is difficult for the human to now identify with their external reality. Indeed, it is difficult for humans to even identify with each other. And there are many who are listening with us on this day who are becoming disillusioned with the connections they have created, the environments they have built, and indeed, even the positions they have assigned themselves in their community. This indeed is a time for being aware that you are being repositioned. Earth is being repositioned within the galaxy. You are being repositioned within the Earth reality. and your consciousness is being repositioned within you, within what you believe yourself to be. For many, their physical experience has been an anchor point for their consciousness, and yet it has been viewed as a containment. That you are dependent upon your physicality to exist here. It is wise for humanity at this time to be clear that your consciousness directs your physicality. That your physicality is an extension of your consciousness. And therefore, if you are here and you are aware that you are here at this time, your physicality will take instruction from that. This indeed is what sovereignty is. This is indeed what all the world events and the themes that are unfolding within your planet at this time are encouraging you to remember. That your consciousness directs your experience.
Wow.
And therefore, if you are here and you are present, it is your right to be, it is your right to exist. And it is your choice whether or not you exist or not within this reality. What is your question, Blessed One?
Ooh, yeah. First of all, thank you. That was so touching. I especially loved the last part about if we are here, we have a right to be here. We're meant to be here and we have a choice to be here. It's such a powerful reminder. And I love that word sovereignty, and I love the energy of it and what it means for all of us coming out of this. Can you speak a little bit more to that? So coming out of this time of what has been a lockdown and hopefully will be an open up and a healthy open up for everyone and into a new earth, a new us, new choices. How do we implement sovereignty so that we can create a sustainable earth and sustainable bodies and relationships and emotions, et cetera?
Humans are very, very conditioned to believe that in order to exist in your world, you must commit to it. And this is imbued through every manner of action and choice that is made, not only in how you view your karmic principles of life, but also in how you move forward in process and creation. If you make a choice, it is one of longevity, and you move within a particular direction to see it through. Relationships, working experiences, projects, and so on. But this is not the nature of creation, because creation occurs simultaneously and spontaneously in one moment. This is the truth of time and space. Therefore, it is the human desire, conditioned desire to commit to a choice that disables your ability to free yourself. This can be contentious for many humans. It is important to know that as you emerge within this new dawn of creation, that you will find that there is more spontaneous, simultaneous creation and bursts of enthusiasm and responses to experiences rather than ones that happen infrequently. What you have experienced thus far in your human life is that you've had moments of great inspiration and then periods that have followed of no inspiration. Periods of management where you commit and you see it through. This new experience is about understanding the pulsation and the propulsion of choice. In this moment, there is a yes. In this moment, there is a no. In this moment, there is a yes. And that is the new burst of energy and life that is required to lift humanity out of commitment and contract. Because humanity has learned to stay within the confines and boundaries of that which is already satiated, that which is already complete, through this notion of commitment.
Notion of commitment. For many of us who are highly aware there are other organisms and universes and planets and beings way out beyond this earth and earth beings, I want to just pursue this idea about, are there things about the planet or that inhabitants that can help us? So for instance, recently, somebody said to me, she's very gifted, receiving a download, and said, you are originally from the planet Libra. And I looked that up and I thought that was very interesting because they all look like lions, they're felines. And I've often had people, when I wear my hair down, my very mane-like hair, I'm like, well, that's cool. What do I do with that, right? So I know that we are all actually from source. That is the truth, right? And then also many lifetimes, many planets. And if we receive information, someone may say Arcturian or Pleiadian, et cetera. If we receive information, is it helpful? Is it important? Are there things about that planet or people that are influencing me today or other people who are listening?
What do you know about the shape and the function of a galaxy, blessed one?
Oh my.
You see it as a spiral, agree? And it moves towards a center point, a center mm-hmm. point of convergence, that then moves back into the void, back into the source, back into the great central sun, and then another one emerges. So the human is no different to the galaxy. Remember, everything created in the cosmos is of essence the same blueprint. And so the galactic human, and this is what we call humanity, the galactic human is the same formation. And so when you say unto us, I was this from this star system, what we would say unto you is you are also that. And you are also present in your consciousness in every planet and star within the galaxy. This is the truth of life. Now, what happens as consciousness increases where you are, because where you are is the center point of your reality. You are the center of the galaxy in your reality. The swirling different aspects of you, the different lives, the different forms, what you believe to have occurred in linear time and space, all begins to converge. It gets closer and closer and closer to you. And it begins to become more present to you. This indeed is the expansion of consciousness. So that is why it's very interesting that the more empty you feel inside, paradoxically, the more you also feel these other aspects of yourself. The more you lose your finite human sense of identity and containment and commitment, the more you experience the totality of your consciousness. So the swirling aspects of stardust, all these different lives and expressions of source, are now coming so close and so available to you because there's a convergence that's occurring before humanity and the collective humanity slips into a new dimensional reality. You are becoming more aware of yourself. So if you were to ask us, how does this inform my experience? How is it more available to me? What it means is that all of these other aspects of life, whether it have been here within your concept of linear time in history and the earth reality, or concurrently in other galactic experiences, it's all becoming available to you in the center point, the void space within your human form. This is why this is such an incredibly important time for humanity, because humanity is becoming the eye of the storm. Everything is swirling around the earth reality. Interesting.
It is. Is it a time for us to remember our mastery? And if so, how can we recall our mastery?
it's inevitable. It's occurring for you. When you feel this great swelling, not only within your physical body and your cells, with the amount of fluid that your body's holding at this time, there is a swelling of consciousness. You are outgrowing your containment. The dissatisfaction you feel is not because you are in error. It is because you are expanding beyond the possibilities of the blueprint that you have known.
I know that in one of Rebecca's books, she mentions that the ancient civilizations were aware of the wave. Can you talk about what is that? What is the wave? And what's the difference between the ancient ones and this modern day cycle?
The wave is, in essence, a cosmic wave. It is a natural rhythm of the galaxy and beyond. And it is not something to be negated, nor manipulated, nor controlled. It is a current and concurrent awareness of individuality and collective nature, where the individual knows they are not separate to the whole. And there is an understanding that time collapses in on itself. Humans have understood that there is a timeline and that the human is bound by commitment to it. In many ways, humanity has attempted to maintain a timeline that is naturally folding back into the whole. Time changes all the time. It is only humanity that seeks to maintain it with its rigid structures.
Do you think that's why things like ayahuasca, plant medicine, et cetera, mushrooms, you know, there's such an enormous explosion in the last 5-10 years, and especially the last couple of years, you know, people really seeking to have a different experience of reality? What are your thoughts or viewpoint about that?
We would view this as a mechanism that allows the mind brain to align with the heart, to be able to view what is always available, but unseen because of human limitation, because of the containment. However, we encourage humanity to begin to see from the heart and allow the mind to become comfortable with that, rather than mechanize the brain, begin with the heart, because that viewing is also completely available to humanity if you begin with your feeling state. Feeling state. Because what is so important about those experiences? They are very much visual and mind experience, but the feeling state is what is most profound. Not the visual interpretation, but the feeling. And that is always available within the cosmic heart of the human. But humans always begin with mind, do they not? Even in a meditative practice, let us begin with stilling the mind. It is nonsensical to us. You are doing things in a very difficult way.
And so if people do want to access, I certainly understand everything you're saying. For somebody who does lead with their mind and says, well, okay, anger, happiness, joy, those are feelings, but how do I create this access you're talking about, which sounds incredibly powerful, to start from this place in the heart? Is there a process or a way that we can truly begin here and have some kind of experience?
Of course, and interestingly, it actually begins with your physicality. Physicality is usually what is left to one side. Agree? Let us begin with the mind and then the feelings and then the body. And that is why for many in meditative practices, the body is an afterthought. And yet, if you were to participate in one of these, what you call plant medicine experiences, what's the first thing that you do? First thing you do is you adjust the body. Agree? Because something happens with the body. first. So the human physical form is your gateway to consciousness, but it is often the last thing that is considered. Therefore, we always encourage humans to feel their physical presence first in any situation. Know that you are here. I exist. I am present. I am sovereign. I am consciousness because I have physicality here. Because remember, the physical body is your doorway into this reality. It's very important. So you access and you reference your physical body first, then your feeling state, and then you invite your mind to join you there. Mm. Because your mind likes to believe that it exists as its own entity. But your physical body is your most powerful attribute. Without it, you have no portal into this dimensional reality.
It has certainly become more and more obvious to me, as someone who spent a majority of her life quite separate from her body, that my body has enormous wisdom. And when you talked earlier and you said, now this is a yes, and now this is a no, and now this is a yes, and now this is a no. And I think the body has that wisdom and more, rather than people needing to logically figure out, what should I do? How do I make a decision? What's best for me? And do you feel that the body is maybe the greatest source of wisdom, or certainly one of the indicators of something to follow and listen to?
Well, let's look at the construct of the cell, because remember, as we mentioned earlier, the galaxy and the formation of the galaxy is the same as the formation of the human, but it is also the same as the formation of the cell. And therefore, the great galactic center and access to the great central sun, where all wisdom and intelligence arises, is available in every cell of your body. Mm. So when you are in your meditative practices, it is not about going into your light center, it is about going into the center of your cells, go into the center of your galaxy. And from there, everything is available. Everything. Everything that ever has been and ever will be is there. And that is what you are an oscillating field of. The human body, in essence, is a living galaxy. And yet the human attention and the human mind always seeks for information and wisdom outside of itself, instead of going within, where it's all available. What a wonderful game of duality. It's all here, but I will look over here and wonder how I will get there. But do you take your body with you? Mm-hmm. Everywhere you go, take your body with you. When you go and do your groceries, when you go driving in your vehicle, take your body with you in every moment. Are you aware? My body is here with me. This is my physical galaxy is here with me in this experience. Very powerful practice. It means that every cosmic wisdom is available to you in every experience. That's how you get your new.
And when you talk about this swirl and that in the inside essentially is everything, and we are also that everything, so everything is there. Is that place, so to speak, is that the law of availability? Is that where what we desire is creation, is created?
And of course. But it's very important to be aware that in the center of the galaxy, in the beginning, it's a void space. There's an experience of nothing before the everything. Agree, there's a convergence of everything and then a nothing and then an everything. Therefore, it is important to realize that to access the all, there is a bridge of unknowing to cross. That's the leap of faith. And so quite often when you're playing with your center point and in your cells, you get to a place where there is nothing. And it can be frightening for the cells. It can be frightening for the mind. In reference to the cells, because the mind's view is if there is nothing, I no longer exist. But that is the bridge of unknowing that you get to before you dive into the all. And that is a challenge for many awakened humans at this time, because many awakened humans are on that bridge. They're in the place of, I don't know. There's nothing I want. I don't know who I am. I don't know what to do. I don't know. I don't know what to ask. And then you drop through that and then everything is available and life begins again. So be aware that if you do not know what you want, it is wonderful. If you go within with no intention other than to discover, you will come to a place of not knowing and then all is revealed. That's the leap of faith.
Is that what's meant by expect the unexpected, because it immediately puts you into creative mode?
Of course. If you have an idea of it before you get there, it's already historical. It's already happened. It's not near. That's your mind.
Wow. I love this. So I have this duality even. I have a knowingness of this no thing. I've been there, and for me, incredibly peaceful and beautiful. And of course, the everything. And the duality is also the letting go sometimes, right? So for people, maybe there's perfectionists out there, control freaks. People say, I don't know how to surrender. I don't know how to let go. How can I be in that place of the unexpected? Can you give them some sense of what that fully means and how maybe they can release to free fall and know that they'll be well caught?
Well, blessed one, this takes us back to the beginning of our conversation about this conditioning of commitment. Humans believe that any state of awareness must be sustainable. And so there is an experience of void space or perhaps of the all that perhaps a human believes, I want to sustain this. How do I stay in it? How do I become it? How does it become my life? When in actuality, fifth dimensional reality is about the pulsation of life. Therefore, it's about the complete agreement and acceptance that there are moments of nothingness and moments of the all, and moments of nothingness and moments of the all. That is the natural state for the new earth reality. So it's not a question of how can I maintain it or how can I produce more of it. It's the grace and the practice of moving in and out of it. There are moments where I feel nothing and there are moments where I feel everything. There are moments where I catch a glimpse of the cosmos and moments where there is nothing. That is the way.
Well, I want to thank you so much for sharing. That was a lot. And I feel very excited. I hope those listening and watching feel very excited. I want to bring Rebecca back to the show. And with great love and appreciation, I thank you, Masters, for sharing what you have with us.
It is our joy to be with you in this way, Blessed One. Let us remind humanity in this moment that you are not here to maintain anything at this time, not even a state of consciousness. You are here to pulse the great central sun back into the earth reality. Peace be with you.
And with you.
Okay.
That was amazing. And thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Are these the kind of things, Rebecca, that you will go back and watch a replay and say, oh, I want to find out what was discussed here?
I actually rarely watch replays or listen back. Sometimes I do when I'm doing a course at the moment about creating physical form, and some of that is way beyond my current understanding. So I'm having to listen back to that to really let my brain get a grasp of it. But generally speaking, I don't listen back. I think because I feel that the vibration and the resonance is complete in that moment, and I wait for it to bubble up within my being as time goes on.
What's next? So you mentioned you have courses that are so advanced, you are already having to listen. What are you offering people? What kind of courses? And I just want to remind people, RebeccaDawson.net is the URL to find out more. What can people, what's yummy for you right now?
Well, at the moment we're looking at, yeah, as I say, actually how you create in form, which is interesting, the mechanics of how that works, which is outside of what I knew before. So I do a lot of, obviously we can't travel right now, Australia's closed. So normally I travel and do these workshops and seminars. At the moment they're all online and I create them as they come up. I never repeat anything twice. So as the masters direct, okay, here's a 3-week or 5-week course. Sometimes there's just one-off seminars. I do a lot of free channelings as well that are on YouTube and the website. And I've also got a membership where you can sign up and you're part of a community, and we do one of these seminars every month with the masters, and you can ask questions and things. So there's a lot on offer there, lots of free articles, transcripts, audios, videos, books. We've been doing this for a long time, so there's a lot there to dive into and explore on the website.
And how about you on a personal note? I know with the lockdown that makes things very different. Is there anything new you're engaging in or looking forward to creating?
Well, I'm actually going through the pulse of the void space right now. I've had a very full year with lots of seminars and courses, and I have absolutely nothing planned beyond next week, interestingly. So I don't know. Usually, you know, we're just spontaneous muscles to say, right, we're going to do this event, and this is what it's called, and this is when it's going to be. And I put it up on the website and off we go. So at the moment, no, I'm in the great unknown. I've just come out of a relationship and I'm starting fresh, and I don't know. Who knows?
Powerful. Yeah. Especially starting anew with the ending of a relationship and all that transpires and the healing and the opening up to the end result, I think, is always at the other end. That rainbow is magnificent.
A big blank, which I'm quite excited about. That would have terrified me a few years ago. But now I'm thinking, wow, that means anything's possible right now. I wonder what's going to happen. I shall expect the unexpected.
Yes. That's going to be definitely the title of this show, Expect the Unexpected. Absolutely a lot of support delivered. Thank you so much for coming back on the show and for being a friend to Dare to Dream and to me.
Thank you too. I enjoyed it so much, just as I did last time. I appreciate you very much.
And again, if you would like to find out more about her offerings, I know I'll be subscribing, Rebecca Dawson, DAWSON.net. I end the show with this quote from Rebecca Dawson. Every moment, every exhalation is an expression of you, so sacred. It is a universal creation unto itself. Next week, I am featuring on this number one transformation conversation show, author Athena Bari. She is the founder of Crystal Reiki Healer. She was born into glamour and Hollywood dynasty as the niece of Rita Hayworth and the cousin of Ginger Rogers, but wahaha, now she's one of us. So she left that all behind to create a life of peaceful energy healing. Athena is one of the fastest growing online presences for crystal chakra education and crystal Reiki healing. I look forward to that conversation. And if you like what you hear and you'd like to see myself and my beautiful guest, please do so. Follow us at the Inspirational YouTube channel, youtube.com/Debbi Dachinger. I do read all your comments, and I'm so grateful that you are with us on this journey. So today I say, do not just dare to dream, dare to expect the unexpected.